What in Electoral Matters, the Independent National Electoral Commission says the concept of placeholder for vice presidential candidates has no place in the Nigerian constitutional and legal framework. INEC National Commissioner and Chairman Information and Voter Education, Festus Okoye, made this known while speaking earlier on the morning show.
Well, there are two basic issues you have raised. The issue of whether there's a place for a placeholder in both our constitutional and legal framework. The Constitution makes it very clear that you cannot run alone as a presidential candidate, that you must nominate an associate to run with you for that particular position. As far as the Independent National Electoral Commission is concerned, the political parties have nominated an associate to run with them as presidential candidates. So as far as we are concerned, there is no form submitted by any of the political parties in terms of their nominations where they said, oh, we are submitting this person's name as a placeholder.
Well, we're now being joined by former director at INEC, Oluwole Osaze Uzi, and chairman, partners for electoral reform, Ezenwa Nwagu. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us on the news tonight.
Let me just kick off with you, Osaze, of course, on this particular matter. Just listening to that report by Adesuwa earlier on, they did say that the president expressed satisfaction with the exercise that took place in Ekiti. Now, this is the same exercise that SDP candidate Segun Oni has described as a rape on democracy and daylight robbery marred with vote buying. What is your take? Osaze, go ahead, please.
Yes. It's become customary for people who lose elections to find blame in every other place than where it should be positioned. I think many independent observers have passed their verdict that it was a very well-conducted election. Fortunately, it was not marred by violence or malpractices, save for voter inducement. I don't like that phrase, vote buying. It sounds legitimate. It's voter inducement. That's what the law calls it, and that's exactly what it is. When Mr. Oni talks about robbery, daylight robbery, I don't know what to make of it. I don't know whether he has his facts. If he does have his facts, I guess he'll have his stay in the tribunal. But from reports that I get from those who were on ground, said, look, the truth was that there was a lot of vote buying, yes. And the vote buying was done by several of the political parties, especially quote-unquote the big parties. So it's a question of who could outbeat the other in terms of inducing voters. So you don't start using the tar brush to tar everybody, and you use the brush. In the meantime, you are completely tarred by whatever vice that affects all those other people. You don't point fingers when you're equally guilty of that, or your people, your surrogates, your members, supporters are equally guilty of that. It doesn't make it right, but voter inducement is a worrisome thing that's been with us for a while. It's a very worrisome thing, and it's something that stakeholders will have to sit down and see what they can do about it. But as to the conduct and fairness of the process, I think the verdict is out on that one. It was a reasonable, well-conducted election.
Okay. Mr. Ezenwa, do you agree? I wonder if you are on ground in Ekiti with wealthy candidates and political parties inducing voters, if you're not using vote buying, can it still be called a fair process, a fair exercise?
The plank of non-partisan election observation is to watch the process. Outcomes are for non-partisans. So what am I interested in Ekiti? I wanted to see when the polls opened, what was the punctuality index, when did the officials get to the polling units, how did we do voter accreditation, counting, sorting and counting, and then the returns made. This process, as we have seen in Ekiti, ran seamlessly. By 7:30 a.m., 75% of the polling officials were already in their polling units. By 8:30, we were having close to almost 90%. And by 10 a.m., you had close to 98% of polling officials in the place. And that accounted for the early calling, making of returns. So, yes, it's true that vote trading inducement, as Mr. Osaze calls it, was prevalent. But that is that like he said, you had to look deeper to be able to see that. It was not done at the polling units. It was done much in a more organized way than we used to see before. And it wasn't one political party. All the dominant political parties were involved in that this thing. But so process-wise, INEC has opportunity now to have some chest thumping and say it has done well. And all the observers on ground can attest to that fact that process-wise, we had a very, very good election.
Getting somewhere, for what you've described right now, we both agree, or both of you agree, that it was vote buying or inducement or whatever term we need to call it. You know, and that really just goes to point to the theme that rang through with the primaries that also took place in most political parties, where, of course, delegates became the star boys or star girls of the day, where, of course, money had to exchange hands to get their vote. Now, with this becoming, would I call it a tradition or a norm, isn't that worrisome? And do you not think that that's enough to cancel elections? If we decide to take it, if we decide to describe it as something that happened across the board, don't you think that if there are no punitive measures, this becomes a practice we're going to have to embrace going forward?
No, we cannot embrace illegality. We just cannot tolerate or embrace illegality. That's clearly, clearly wrong. It's morally wrong. It's legally wrong. The truth is that voter inducement, voter bribery has been with us for quite a while. It's just become more prevalent now, and it's become more in the fore because before there were all sorts of malpractices, and it just formed one part of the malpractice. But now, with the limited chance for malpractices, I think it's become the major focus of our attention. It cannot become the norm, whether it's in the primaries or whether it's become whether it's in a general election. It's clearly wrong, and it's such that. Yes, it does affect the credibility of a process. It means that it's the money bags, those who have the most money, who will probably now determine the outcome of elections. Whereas elections should be a free process, free-minded people based on their convictions, not on the size of a person's wallet.
So now, how do you plan to curb this? If there are no punitive measures attached to it, isn't it just a free-for-all?
But there are punitive measures attached to it. The bribery is an offense, both in the normal civil law and normal criminal law, and also in the under the Electoral Act. Bribing somebody, tell him to vote this way or not to vote that way, trying to induce them to vote is against the law. The question now will now be, how do we enforce these laws? INEC is doing its own bit in terms of voter education, voter enlightenment, but it's a difficult task, especially with widespread prevalent poverty in the land. It's difficult to, these people see it as free money, not understanding the dynamics, not understanding that this is even making matters worse, because those who give you that money will also try to recover those sums. I hope that going forward, that with the collaboration with the EFCC, ICPC, the security, other security agencies, perhaps we should get the wholesalers, those who bring out the money, not so much the downstream, not so much the retailers, but the wholesalers who bring out the money, trace and track how this money is being used. And there are more than enough laws to take care of those situations.
Indeed. Mr. Ezenwa, are the laws not elaborate enough? How do we discourage this?
Well, we need to increase voter education. We came from a place where you were going to vote at some point, and the results of where you are voting will be announced. So we've overcome that. We are coming to a place where votes are counting, and that is why the politicians are buying the votes. Some of these monies that I used to buy votes used to be domiciled within the electoral management body, and so we've overcome that through the infusion of technology and a lot of oversight around the activities of INEC, to the point where the issues around logistic challenges and the rest of them have been overcome. If we also pay the kind of attention we have paid to bring us to where we are in terms of the process, we will be able to also overcome the issue of vote buying. Take, for instance, what happened in Ekiti. The traditional moral authority of the traditional ruler of Ekiti, of Ado, was brought on the NURTW to ensure that they don't frustrate the logistics arrangement of INEC, and it worked. So we can bring these traditional moral authorities, political authority, and then ensuring that those who we have, for instance, arrested in Ekiti are also, you know, made examples by prosecuting them openly and then naming and shaming them. Otherwise, we are not going to get the kind of outcome that we are looking for.
Vote buying that we saw during this election. Let me bring into the studio to you, Osazeuzi. We also saw the numbers of people who came out or the ones who didn't come out. When I looked at those numbers, compared it to the last election in Ekiti 2018, there was actually a decline. So what would you say was responsible for this? We didn't have so much of security challenges in Ekiti. You've both praised INEC's performance and the processes. What do you think was responsible for this low voter turnout?
Well, it's difficult to say. Some people might argue that people feel they haven't been those, what they term dividends of democracy. People don't have too much faith in voting for people and whether they will do what they have promised to do. That may be there. Fortunately, there's not a security challenge. But in I like to see this thing in context. Mm-hmm. The context is that, look, I think the official turnout was about 36.74%. Now, that is when you compare it to the total number of registered voters. But that is not an inclination of those who wish to vote. Those who wish to vote should be computed based on the number of permanent voter cards collected.
Indeed.
Because when you look at voters cards collected, you probably find you are now hitting over 56%, which is not where we should be, but it's still a fair and much better average than compared to 36%. So I think we should start looking at things in terms of those eligible to vote. It's not just those who are registered to vote, but those who have collected it over this card. Several of those people who registered in 2011 up to 2022 may have died, may have relocated, may have left the Ekiti state. You know, there are lots of reasons for it, but I don't know why people will not turn up. I think with the increased faith in the system, with increased faith that your votes will count, whether it's going to make a difference to governance, whether it will lead to good governance, whether it will lead to those what they call the dividends of democracy, we don't know, but hopefully that will encourage more people going forward to turn up to vote.
Well, thank you very much for that. You've been speaking to a former director at INEC, Oluwole Osazeuzi, and chairman partners for electoral reform, Ezenwa Wago, on the news tonight.